past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Good morning, good morning. Welcome. Merry Christmas, everybody. Hi. So, just want to welcome everybody here, whether you're here physically or streaming with us. We're glad to have you. If you are here physically, please fill out the Connect card in the bulletin. That way we know you've been here, and that way we also know if you would like prayer requests. I know it is the day after Christmas, but we're going to talk about something that's not Christmassy. Did everybody have a good Christmas, though? Wonderful. So, since it's the day after Christmas, are you guys even thinking yet about the new year?
No.
That is a great answer. Did you guys know that one of the best places to start your new year is right here in church?
Yes.
Amen. It's the best way to do it. The Bible promises that God has great plans for our future. Here at church, we can get ready for whatever God has planned. Knowing God is preparing the way for us gets us excited and hopeful for what is to come. So no, we haven't left December yet, but I am also ready. I am just ready to be excited for 2022. What do y'all think? Amen. Woo-hoo-hoo! So I have got some shoes up on the screen. I got some worn shoes, and I have some new shoes. So let's talk about the worn shoes. The worn shoes are going to represent 2021 for us. Whether you were on a team at school, whether you used it to go grocery shopping for mom, whether you used it to run away from the neighbor's dog. Audrina, see? She knows. She used it to, that was you? Did you run away from the neighbor's dog? Oh, no. But at the end of the year, this may be what your shoes look like, right? With everything that you do. And then usually the next year round, you get shoes for school. And then what happens to your old shoes? What do you call them? That is a great answer. Now, in my house, you didn't throw away shoes. They had to be really worn. They became my play shoes. That was my play shoes. If I went out and played, I played in the old shoes. But the new shoes are going to represent 2022. You look at the new shoes, think of all the great things that could happen this year to come. Think of the new friends that you might meet. Think of the new sports you may do in school. Now, Reagan, she swims. I don't think you're going to wear these shoes, dear, swimming. But you do wear water shoes, so those will work for you. But, you know, I'm excited for 2022 just because this year's been kind of a roller coaster. So I'm ready. Y'all ready for New Year?
Yes.
I'm ready for New Year. But if you look back, if you look at the old shoes or the new shoes, these shoes probably smell brand new. They are shiny and clean, no scuffs, marks, or stains. The shoestrings have no wear marks. So if you look at the shoes, they're new. The shoes are ready to head into the new year. These shoes are shoes of the future. Where will the person go in these shoes? What do you think the person will do? Doesn't matter what the person does or will do, but the fact is that God is going to be with them. Yes. Amen. God has taught us many things. Our old shoes that we wore through last year brought us to the beginning of this new year to come. We need to be thankful for all that we've gone through and all that God has taught us in the past year. So now here we are, almost to the beginning of the new year. We are ready for God to lead us on a new path, do the hard work God calls us to do to make the new year a great year. When we get to the end of this new year, let's hope our shoes tell the story of the job well done. Amen. Reagan, give me a thumbs up. Amen. Oh, I got two. How about everybody? Give me a thumbs up. Woo-woo! All right, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are just so ready for 2022. We are so ready for what you have in plan for us, and just to put on our new shoes and to go out into the world and share who you are and to be your hands and your feet. Guide us as we go along this path that you have called us on. It's your name we ask all these things. Amen. Now, we do have kids' church today, so for the kids that would like to come, if you just come over here by the wall, we'll go over. Say bye, guys.
Bye, guys.
Bye. Good morning, Lakeshore family. Good morning. Hope you guys had an awesome Christmas, and I don't know about you guys, but I'm excited for this new year. I think God is going to light this place up in a beautiful way, and I have great faith that this church is going to grow beyond our wildest imagination. So let's stand and sing and worship the God of life and resurrection. Glad you all came as you are today. You're all beautiful. Come out of sadness, wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, a sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken,
so lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you
are. The hopeless and all who have strayed, come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary and rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your as you are. joy for the morning. Oh, sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So let's lay down our burdens, lay down our shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. A wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart. Come as you are. Come as you are. So glad we can come as we are today. My intentions, all my obsessions, I want to lay them all down in your hands. Only your love is vital, though I'm not entitled. Still, you call me your child. God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands off of my life in the way it should go. Oh, God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to open my hands up and give you control. I give you control.
I had plans shattered and broken. The things I had hoped in fall through my hand. You have plans to redeem and restore me. You're behind and before me. Oh, help me to believe.
Oh, God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands on my life and the way it should go. Oh, God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to open my hands up and give you control. I give you control.
I give you control. Lord, I give you control. I give you control.
This world has lost its grip on me, and
you want me. Somehow you want me. The King of Heaven wants me. So this world has lost its grip on me, and you want me. Somehow you want me. The King of Heaven wants me. So this world has lost its grip on me. Grip on me. Yeah, you want me. He wants every last one of us.
The world has lost his grip on me.
Thank God you want me.
This world has lost its grip on me.
Amen.
Step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope for a life spent with you.
So here I am to worship. Here I am. Altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Upon that cross, and I'll never.
my God, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
You know, I see a theme that kind of has unfolded. We're here, we're all still in our dirty shoes, our old 2021 shoes. Came as we are, inside and out. We came as we are, inside and out. I know most of us are glad that we can be different on the outside so people don't have to see all of our insides. That's okay, because you're in the right place. You don't have to reveal anything of yourself to anybody else, because God knows, and He's here for you. He's here. He's here for you. Amen. So here we are to worship. Here we are to bow down our hearts and our lives. Thank you, Lord, that you take us, you let us come as you are. People come and see you as we are. And different ones of us have different needs. We're glad that we can be here and worship you. But some of us also are just really hurting at a complete loss in life of what to do next. We're all here, Lord. Pray that you will give us inspiration and wisdom for life, for what we should do with our lives and where we should go with our lives. I pray, Father, that you would give wisdom where wisdom is needed. I pray for those who need another chance. I pray for those who need a break. I pray, Father, for those who need a friend. Father, may we find all those things in you and with your people, is my prayer. And I pray, God, that as we open up the scriptures to learn more about you, that you'll open our hearts for that as well. Lovingly, Lord, we make these prayers to you in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Please be seated and prepare yourself now to give to God out of your resources in accordance with how He has blessed you. God never asked anybody to impoverish themselves for me. Me? Okay. Says they need more of me. A little more me. Imagine that. Give as the Lord leads you to give.
I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know just how much it costs to see my sins upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sins upon that cross. Here we are to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful.
to me. Amen.
Here we are. The scripture passage that we have this morning is from Luke chapter 2, verses 15 through 21. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread... Just a second. Do you realize how weird it is to find a baby in a manger? You know what a manger is? It's a feeding trough where the donkeys eat. Go down to the corner of Lane and Wilson, and you'll find a baby in the shovel of a dump of a bulldozer. Go down, take two rights and a left. You'll find a newborn baby in a mail carrier's bag. It was weird, folks. The problem is that we have all the Christmas carols and all of the 2,000 years of... It was weird for Jesus to be laid in a feeding trough. But it was a sign, and we'll get to that in a second. See, that's the problem when I start preaching before I finish reading the scriptures. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, I went backwards. See, I planned to go backwards in my sermon, but I didn't mean to read backwards for y'all. Y'all got me all messed up. Huh? Thanks. Could you just come on up here and help me finish this? Okay, when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what they had been told about him, about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise him, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he had been conceived. A number of years after all of this took place, the gospel writer Luke made it a point to meet Mary and talk to her. By the time of Luke writing this gospel, Jerusalem was the center of Christianity. Her other son, James, ironically, who had rejected Jesus, was now the leader of the church. And then John, the apostle, was there, whom Jesus had told to take care of his mother. And so most likely when Paul came to Jerusalem for his last visit there before he was executed, Luke made some time to talk with Mary. Now you're going to say to me, how do I know that? Well, we find in Luke's gospel things that we don't find in the other gospels. In fact, we've learned almost nothing about the early days from anyone but Luke. A little bit in Matthew, nothing in Mark, very little in John. So Luke, who was a detail guy, I probably wouldn't have liked him. I'd have liked him because, you know, I like all kinds of people, but we wouldn't have been golfing buddies. Because Luke, if I played golf with Luke, every time I touched my ball, he'd call it a stroke, you know. So I play with Willis. He doesn't do that to me. Willis has great empathy for my inability to play golf. He does. He does. So Luke was a detail guy, and he got all this stuff. And he talked with Mary to find out what happened in those early days. And so Mary, who has pondered all these things in her heart, she stored those memories. And then she gave them to Luke. And Luke wrote a gospel, and now we have it. The question, a good question is, why the shepherds? Why the shepherds? For this big, dramatic debut. For the first people to meet Jesus. Why the shepherds? Well, you could say, well, they were there, you know, as though God stumbled upon the whole thing and said, well, let's just use what we've got. But that doesn't sound right, does it? No, it doesn't. There were others, for certainly more worthy. There were craftsmen around. There were businessmen around. The Magi. Now, the angels could have appeared to the Magi. They were certainly no people of noble birth, and they were seeking truth. They would be worthy. But ironically enough, the most noble people that wound up coming to see Jesus were coming to him, not making him come to them. Do you ever have, this is stirring a pot that doesn't need to be stirred, but hey, it's me. Do you ever have conflicts at holidays about who's going to go to whose house? Yeah. See, now, the conflict that I think should not even be a conflict is when you have relatives that come down from Wisconsin and they're going to go stay with some of your relatives over in Lauderdale. And you want them to come to Jacksonville. Hey, I came from Wisconsin. You can come to Lauderdale, right? That makes sense. Not with families, it doesn't. And so it begins. But Jesus, the Magi, the three kings, as we call them, they were coming to find Jesus, and they were coming from farther than Wisconsin. They were coming from the Far East. And they were in earnest to go see him. But that's another story. Now, it seems to me that if the angels that night had appeared to the religious leaders, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the Sanhedrin, the scribes, the ones who gave Jesus such a hard time in life, if the angels had just appeared to them, there'd have been so much less fuss and bother. There'd have been so much less pain. Might not have been a crucifixion either. So, God knows best. God knows best. But it was the shepherds, the lowest on the working class totem pole, the poorest, the most unsophisticated, young and old. Why? Why the shepherds? Now, if you don't get anything else today, I want you to get this. When you read the Beatitudes, blessed are they who are meek, blessed are the poor, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are... When you read about the shepherds, when you read about the people that Jesus stopped to help, God has favorites in the Bible. And the people that God favors the most, I'm telling you the truth. Everybody has favorites. Some of us have favorite children and we've never told anybody, a single soul. It doesn't mean we love the other children less. It means that there was something about your relationship with this one child that just was always different and always special. You'd still die for the other children and everything, but people have favorites, you know? We have favorites because we're human beings. But guess what? God has favorites. God, according to his word of the Holy Bible, Hannah, who couldn't have a baby, God gave her a baby. You know? The poor. The unrepresented. The poorly represented. The downtrodden. The ones who are taking advantage. These are God's favorite people. Now here's the flash for us here today. God takes special care and concern today for the people who need that care and concern the most. Let me go back one step again, and because I want to be clear about this. Do I think God loves some people more than the other? No, of course I don't think that. Sometime back, Lauren, my youngest daughter, said, "Dad, do you have favorites amongst the three of us? I have three children. Lauren, the youngest, Nathan, my son, who's in the middle, and Carissa, who's the oldest." And I said, "Yes." I said yes. I said, "When you got in trouble at school, dyed your hair pink, started taking drugs, you were my favorite. And I spent more time with you than the others. When we moved to Kentucky for me to go to seminary and Carissa had such a hard time fitting in, and she cried at school every day, and I went up to the school every day and sat with her at lunch and talked with her, and she was my favorite." So when Nathan, when we found out that he had a developmental problem where at age 8 he had the motor skills of a 4-year-old, and he couldn't write and he couldn't do anything in school, he was my favorite. So that's what I mean when I say God has favorites. And I really spent more time on this than I intended, but let me tell you who they are. They are the poor. They are the people who are consistently overlooked in life. I don't mean politically, and I don't mean economically completely. I mean people who are homeless. I mean people who are mentally ill. I mean people who take drugs to black out the horror of their childhood. I mean people who have gone beyond the ability to help themselves and have fallen into a place where they pray for death. People like that were outside that night. We call them shepherds. Now, maybe none of them had any of those problems that I've mentioned. But at that time, they were God's favorites. And so God chose them to tell this great big news to. And they loved it. It was awesome for them. I don't read anybody say, "Hey, so who's got the sheep right now? They completely forgot about everything and they were about this great adventure that God was bringing them into. So that's why the shepherd. Well, they were excited, and they were so excited that they ran to find out where Mary and Joseph were. Now think about the story, folks. How are they going to know where Mary and Joseph are? Let's have a little dialogue. How are they going to know where Mary and Joseph are? Huh? Was there light? GPS. Think about it. They were what he said. We give you this sign. You will find a babe, and the word here. Okay, the original word here specifically describes a newborn babe. You seen a newborn babe, like born just in the last 2-3 hours? They're all pink, you know, kind of still bumpy and ruffled up and maybe still not completely dry, you know. Wrapped in cloths. What's the third part of the sign? Lying in a manger. A manger is furniture for what kind of building? Right. Okay. So, we start going from stable to stable. And I don't know about the other part, But if we see a baby in a trough, bingo. Right? And they did. And as soon as they got there, whoever the spokesperson was for the shepherds said, look, this is what just happened to us. And told them. Said, you know, we saw the angels and we were as afraid as we could be. But the angel told us, don't be afraid. Said that we would find you this way, that you'd be, the baby would be here and he'd be a brand new baby and he'd be all wrapped up in cloth. And he'd be in this trough. And then he said, and after he told us this, the sky split open. And these soldier-like angels, it says. Now, how would they look like soldiers? Carrying a sword? Carrying a sword, maybe a shield or something like that? It says specifically the word is the word for soldier. Soldier angels, they were called. We saw them, but they all sang, all of them, more than we could count. They sang glory to God in the highest, all of them at the same time. So we came here. Now, here's something very interesting. Maybe you can, since this is the 11 o'clock service, we can slip and slide a little bit. Verse 18, I'll tell you what, there are fewer people at the early service than there are amongst you right now. I was just checking eyelids, boy. Now, verse 18. Get with me here. Verse 18. And all who heard it were amazed. Who was there? Mary and Joseph. And what? And the shepherds. Okay, the shepherds had already heard it, right? The animals didn't care. So that takes it down to who? And all who heard it. Does that strike you as a little interesting? Yeah. 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 I'm thinking that the... The stable started to get crowded that night. But Luke wrote it, and all who heard it. I wish Mary had told him a little bit more. Yeah, the town emptied out, and everybody was standing there, and I was trying to catch a couple of winks while the baby was asleep. You know? That's it. But Mary was not surprised. Mary had already had experiences that no human being had ever had. She was just taking it in. She was creating a scrapbook in her mind. She reflected. She reflected on what the shepherds said. She reflected on her husband Joseph and how he handled everything. She reflected on their surroundings. And probably felt thankful that it wasn't worse, that they weren't out in the open someplace. The shepherds' lives were changed forever. I would love to have been able to hear some old shepherd who had been a young shepherd back in the day tell the account of what took place. I really, that would have been exciting to hear. But I come back to Mary. I think about what took place. I think about how she took it all in. And it leaves me with the question. Mary, did you know? Together, remember that The elements of our communion are the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, the emblems of that sacrifice. You don't have to be a member of this church to take communion. If you love God, if you're seeking God, if you're thankful to have your sins forgiven or you're wanting to have your sins forgiven, you're welcome to take communion at this table. Please stand and come to the center aisle, and we'll go from front to back. stand with me, would you? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and grant you peace. Go in peace, the Lord be with you. Amen.
God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands off of my life the way it should go. Oh, God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to open my hands up and give you control.
Give you control, give you control.
And you want me, you want me.
King of heaven wants me.
So this world has lost its grip on me.
Somehow you want me, the King of heaven wants me.
So this world has lost its grip on me. This world has lost its grip on me.